Gracious Heavenly Father, thank you so much that we're able to gather on this Resurrection Sunday to give you glory and honor. We thank you so much for all the talents and all the gifts and all the wonderful things that you've given us and just the opportunity by your grace to give it right back. We love you and we thank you, and may your name be glorified today. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's sing.
Isn't the goodness of God so wonderful for us? Let us sing.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me all my days. I've been held in your hands from the moment that I wake up until till I lay my head. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Jesus, we worship you and we praise you. Thank you, God, for your blood.
Separated, the bridge was far too wide. on the far side of the chasm, you held me in your sight, and you made a way across the great divide. Left behind heaven's throne to build it here inside. And there at the cross you paid the debt I owed, broke my chains, freed my soul. For the first time I
as they guarded the grave. One day, 2 days, 3 days had passed. Could it be that Jesus breathed his last? Could it be that his father had forsaken him, turned his back on his son, despising our sin? All hell seemed to whisper, just forgive him, he's dead. Then the father looked down to his son and said, from heaven the stone was rolled away, and this dead man, the guards, they all stood there in fright as the power of love displayed its might.
Then suddenly a melody filled the air, riding was everywhere. The
Gracious Heavenly Father, thank you so much that we can gather together today on the Lord's Day, the culmination of history. Lord, help us to have eyes to see and ears to hear this morning. And Holy Spirit, would you preach to us and help me to get out of the way? We love you and thank you for what you've done and are doing in and through and around us. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. He is risen. Amen. Amen. Turn in your Bibles to Luke 24. Luke 24. If you're new with us, I'm glad that you came here this morning, and I hope that you've encouraged today. I've already been encouraged, just reminded of the fact that children are a blessing from the Lord. Children are a blessing from the Lord, guys. So we've been going through a series on the life and teachings of Jesus from the book of Luke. And the sermon title today is, He is Worthy. He is Worthy. If you've heard the popular song on the radio, I think they played on the radio by Andrew Peterson. That's kind of where I came from with this. So if you haven't heard that, check it out. It's one of the most beautiful songs that I've ever heard. It's called, Is He Worthy? So I flipped it around. Is He Worthy? He is Worthy. All right. So I'm not going to talk mainly from Luke 24 today, but I'm sure that many of you, it's not that I can't. Trust me, many of you can probably attest at this point that I could make two verses go for 2 hours, but I promise I won't do that today. It is Easter. But this is really going to springboard us into other aspects of the resurrection that I would really like us to think about today, which means we're going to talk about the gospel this morning. We're going to talk about the gospel. So in order for it to be good news, I have bad news too. But we'll get to the good news, I promise. Luke chapter 24. On the first day of the week, at early dawn, they came to the tomb bringing the spices which they had prepared. And they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. And when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were perplexed about this, behold, two men suddenly stood near them in dazzling clothing. And as the women were terrified and bowed their faces to the ground, the men said to them, Why do you seek the living one among the dead? He is not here, but he has risen. Remember how he spoke to you while he was still in Galilee, saying that the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men, and be crucified, and the third day rise again. And they remembered his words. It's the word of the Lord. So most of us have heard the main idea of this passage some way, shape, or form. Unless you've been living under a rock, you haven't heard about Jesus rising from the dead. So here comes this group of women at dawn, and this stone to Jesus' tomb is rolled away. By the way, the stone's not rolled away so Jesus can get out. It's rolled away so they can get in. Jesus didn't need the stone moved to get out. He walks through walls in other places. It's clear from the other gospel accounts as well as other places in the Bible that the beings described as having dazzling clothes are in fact angels. So these two angels tell these women that Jesus is not there, but he is risen. So they remind them of Jesus' own foretelling that he would be delivered into the hands of sinful men, be crucified, and on the third day, he will rise again. So if you're new with us today, like I said, I could spend the whole time talking about this, but I'm not going to do that. And why? I'll tell you why. Because I want to talk about the significance of the resurrection. I want to talk about what it means. So the resurrection of Jesus Christ is the most important moment in history, this side of glory. It's what the Old Testament was pointing forward to, and it's what we look back to today. It's the climactic moment of history, which truly is, it's in the word, guys, his story. How can I possibly talk about the glories of this moment in 40 minutes? I can't. Hopefully I don't go too long, but we can catch a glimpse of this majestic moment prepared before the foundation of the world. So, again, why is my sermon titled, He is Worthy? What do I mean by worthy? Well, for starters, the definition of the word worth is this: the quality that renders something as valuable or desirable, or that which has merit. He, the Lord Jesus Christ, is worthy in every single way you can conceive of that word worth. So I'm going to ask you the most important question that you can ask yourself in this life. And I want you to ask yourself this right now. Do you know him? Do you know Jesus? Now think about this for a minute. Do you not know him? Do you know him? I'm not asking if you know who he is. I'm not asking if you know about him. The demons know who he is. The demons know who he is, guys. That's not it. Have you come to the same point as the Apostle Paul did? And he wrote this in Philippians chapter 3, verses 7 and 8. He says this: but whatever things were gained to me, those things I have counted as loss for the sake of Christ. More than that, I count all things to be lost in view of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and count them but rubbish so that I may gain Christ. So think about this. Can you echo that verse in your own heart? Do you see the worth in that statement? I count all things to be lost in the view of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. Church, do you know him? Do you know him? I'm not talking about theological studies. Those are good too. It's good to study. That's more about God. I'm not talking about knowing about God. Do you know him? Or do you just like to speculate about when the world will end? Do you like to talk about end time studies and eschatology? That's good too, but that's not it. Do you know him? I'm not talking about coming here on Sunday morning and putting some money in a plate. I'm talking about a relationship. Do you know who he is? Do you know him? So let's talk about the resurrection. If you have your Bible, go ahead and turn to 1 Corinthians 15. 1 Corinthians 15. This is where we're going to spend most of our time this morning. Why is the resurrection of Jesus Christ the most important event we can talk about? For starters, if Jesus didn't raise from the dead, we're all wasting our time here. We're all wasting our time. So C.S. Lewis used a description of Jesus, saying he is one of three things based on the claims that he made. Jesus was either a liar, a lunatic, or Lord. Liar, lunatic, or Lord. If he didn't rise from the grave, then he would fall into one of the other categories, not the one we know him as. So if he really believed what he said, and it didn't happen, he was crazy. He was a lunatic. If he told the disciples the things were going to take place, and he knew they wouldn't happen, but he told them anyway, then he was a liar. However, if he prophesied everything he did, accomplished what he said he was going to do, and then rose from the grave, well, then he is Lord. Scripture agrees with this concept. So first, I want to take a look at 1 Corinthians 15, verses 12 through 22, and this passage will help us understand what the resurrection accomplished. If you don't have it in front of you, you can just follow along with me. Now, if Christ is preached that he has been raised from the dead, how do some among you say that there is no resurrection of the dead?
But if there is no resurrection of the dead, not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is in vain. Your faith also is in vain. Moreover, we are even found to be false witnesses of God because we testified against God that he raised Christ, whom he did not raise, if in fact the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is worthless. You are still in your sins. Then those who have fallen asleep or have died in Christ have perished. If we have hoped in Christ in this life only, we are of all men most to be pitied. Stop right there for now. You see what's being laid before us here. If Jesus didn't rise from the dead, we have no reason to be here. Paul is saying that we are the most to be pitied by mankind because if we believe in something that didn't happen, it's hopeless. If Jesus didn't come back to life, then believing in him does no good either because he has no power over death. Which brings us to the first point. Because of sin, it is appointed for men to die once. Death is a reality we all must face. I know this is a bleak topic for Easter Sunday, but death, I cannot talk about the resurrection of Christ if I don't talk about death. And you won't understand it if we don't come to grips with death. So this might get dark for a minute, but hang with me. If you haven't thought about death, then you need to. Ecclesiastes 3:11 says that God placed eternity into men's heart. Do you know what that means? It means you don't want to die. It means it's a very natural thing to desire to live forever. But the reality of the situation is that we're all going to die, unless Jesus comes back. This is also the reason that it feels so wrong when we experience death around us. Take any funeral experience that you've been to, any of them. Some of us have been to the more tragic funeral services when someone died way before their time. I can think of, and as I said that, some of you probably had faces pop in your mind, but I can think of at least three men that I grew up around with that are all dead. I'm 33, young folks. And some of the ones that I'm talking about didn't make it to 20. I want you to take that to heart. I remember walking through the funeral line as a high school student for one of them in particular and feeling a deep sense of injustice. I didn't truly know the Lord, and I remember thinking this, though. I remember thinking, this is wrong. This is not the way this is supposed to be. Why do things happen like this? You see, God's word has a way of shedding light on things when we don't understand. That's eternity on man's heart. We know other examples of people that have died from sickness or disease. It doesn't make it any better. But notice this, even when we have a loved one that lives well into their 90s, it still hurts. It still hurts. It still feels wrong. You can't go see them anymore. You can't pick up the phone and call them. It hurts. Even the most accomplished, long life can bring sorrow to those close to the dead. So even though we don't want to talk about it, it's a fate we can't escape. The living should take note of the dead. You are going to die. We don't know how much time we have. Nothing is guaranteed. We have no guarantee about how much time we have. Sickness, sorrow, pain, and death are present realities for us all because of sin. Sin. Now, some of you might think, that's a bit general, don't you think? Every single bad or evil thing that happens in this life boiled down to sin? Can you do that? Yes, I can. Because that's what the Bible says. And I'll read this passage to you too. Or you can write it down. I'm going to quote quite a few scriptures as I go along this morning. But Romans 8, 19 through 22. Romans 8 is probably one of the most beautiful chapters in the Bible. If you don't read anything else that I tell you about today, go read Romans 8. Romans 8, 19 through 22. For the anxious longing of the creation waits eagerly for the revealing of the sons of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself also will be set free from its slavery to corruption into the freedom of the glory of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation groans and suffers the pains of childbirth together until now. The creation was subjected to futility and desires freedom from sin and its corruptive effects. Labor pains, from what I've told and what I've witnessed, appear to be very painful. That's the sign of creation groaning. But once the baby is born, the pain is no longer thought of, only holding the baby and celebrating new life. So it is with creation. It's eagerly awaiting to be made new, to be released from sin. The whole creation is groaning with the eager expectation of being freed from the bonds of sin. So how was creation subjected to sin? Man's disobedience in the Garden of Eden. Adam and Eve had one rule, one thing they couldn't do. Did not eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. The serpent deceives Eve with this promise, serpent and devil, you will be like God. After being tempted by the serpent, they believed his lie and ate of the forbidden fruit. Sin was ushered in by the fall of mankind. Now think about this. Adam sinned willingly in a lush garden free of sin, while Christ refused to sin in a desert of agony in a world bent towards sin. You ever think about that? Adam sinned willingly in a lush garden free of sin, while Christ refused to sin in a desert of agony in a world bent towards sin. It's amazing. Another thing we need to realize. When Adam and Eve sinned, we want to talk about justice, fairness. We like to talk about being fair in the land of the free. Let me talk to you about fairness. When Adam and Eve sinned in the garden, God could have done away with them right there. Could have done away with us right there. But that's not what he does. He didn't have to provide a redemption, but in love, he did. Now, notice this. I'm going to read you another verse. Genesis 3:15. This is God talking to the serpent. This is God talking to the devil. And he says this in verse 15 of Genesis 3. I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise you on the head, and you shall bruise him on the heel. That is a redemptive statement. It's a promise from God. Right out the gate, the seed of the woman will crush the head of the serpent. This is the first mention of the gospel. Genesis 3. We only got three chapters into the Bible and we're already talking about the gospel. You may have had a child ask you this question before. I've asked this question before. It's a common skeptical question. Well, so why did God put the tree in the garden? My daughter's already asked me that question. I'm not going to answer the question for you, but I'm going to let you notice something. Right out the gate, the blame shifts to God. Right out the gate. Why'd you put the tree there? It's this woman you gave me. Right after disobedience, God promises redemption. Did God make Adam and Eve? Ask yourself that question. Did God make Adam and Eve eat of the tree? No. They chose it freely because they believed the lie. They believed the lie. So why? Here's the better question is this. It's what we're talking about. Why did God offer redemption right after disobedience? That doesn't make sense to us. That's not fair. That's not just. Adam and Eve chooses disobedience, and God promises redemption. This truly is a foretaste of good news. The question is this: what was the cost of man's redemption? What was the cost? Like I said, hang with me. I know this is dark. I know it's Easter Sunday. It's like, man, sin. I know, but you're going to come out better for it. And if you really want to understand the gospel, then you have to understand the bad news. If you don't understand the bad news, then the good news won't be that good to you. It'll be cheap grace. I don't want you to see cheap grace. I want you to see amazing grace. After the fall of man, sin entered the world. Men are born in their natural state as, here it comes, enemies of God. I thought all people were born, you know, okay, good people. No, the Bible tells us, get the anthropological study of man right there, all men are born enemies of God. Every man or woman mimics the same sin as our great ancestor, the idolatry that follows wanting to be like God. We want to take his place in our lives as the master of everything. It's my life. It's my story. I will do what I want. I will do what thou wilt. And what is the result of that? Evil, problems, theft, murder, covetousness, idolatry, sexual immorality, broken homes, divorce, selfishness, blame shifting, you name it. You bumping into me and me bumping into you as we seek the pleasures of this world, all wanting to be on the throne. If anybody gets in the way, it doesn't matter because John Bon Jovi told me on the radio, it's my life. And anything that comes across the radio has to be right. Somebody else, here it is, somebody else is the problem in my life. It can't possibly be me. Oh, Lord, it's hard to be humble. Sin can make us so miserable that we're always looking outward to blame something else. But even in the quest for pleasure and pride, we find ourselves disappointed. Blaming other people is one thing. I've already mentioned this. But also, how quick are we to blame God for the circumstances? God, why do bad things happen to good people? God, why do you make me like this? If God wanted me to be different, here's the big excuse. If God wanted me to be different, he would have made me different. You do you, I'll do me. Most out of context verse, there might be another one, but this is the one that comes to mind. Judge not, brother, lest ye be judged. If you've heard that and somebody used it out there, it's probably not what it was intended to mean. The flesh, or the natural state, this is the point that we're born into, it makes us really good at lying to ourselves. We're really good at lying to ourselves. Again, you're probably thinking, hey, come on, lighten up, man. It's Easter Sunday. What are you talking about lying to myself? Come on, tell me some good news. What does any of this have to do with the resurrection? It has everything to do with the resurrection. It has everything to do with this topic. Sin and death have everything to do with Jesus rising from the grave. And I want you to grasp the weight of that truth. I want you to see what he accomplished. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. No man can justify himself by works of the law, but God's law is good if one uses it lawfully. It's not the law that's bad, it's the sinners. God's law is good. You know, again, we have to understand the bad news before we can really understand the good news, before it gets really good news. One theologian put it like this: the needle of the law, think of a sewing needle, the needle of the law pierces our hearts to welcome in the thread of the gospel. So I ask you this, brother, sister, have you ever felt the weight of your sin? Have you ever cried out to God? Have you ever felt conviction? Have you ever felt broken? Have you ever looked around and noticed how broken the world is? The Bible tells us to examine ourselves. And church, this is the rub. If you start examining yourself, you won't be pleased. Without a Savior, we have no hope. We die in our sins. There would be no path of redemption. Life would be much like the prevalent secular humanist worldview today. You're stardust, I'm stardust, and we're all floating around on this rock in the galaxy through the universe, and we're just here. The atheist looks up at the stars at night and thinks, oh, happy accident. No, faith says the heavens declare the glory of God and the sky reveals his majesty. So let's come to the second point. Jesus bore the wrath owed to you and me. Enter Jesus Christ. We've been talking about you. We've been talking about me for a while. Let's talk about Jesus now. Totally God, totally man, he humbles himself down to our level in frail humanity. The word that John spoke of is humbled down in the form of a man. In the beginning, yeah, didn't get you. In the beginning, I thought I was going to hear God created the heavens and the earth. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And that Word became flesh, took on human form. That is amazing. He lives the perfect life. He is tempted by Satan and never gives in. He never sinned once. Why? For the joy set before him endured every trial all the way up to the point where he's hoisted up on a cross for you and me. And I want you to think about the crucifixion. If you have your Bible, Matthew 27, I'll try to stop making you flip, but it's really good if you look at this one. Matthew 27, I'm going to look at verses 41 and 42, and I'm going to take a drink while you turn there, because I'm getting winded. Human frailty. The scoffers are standing by, and the gospel records this statement of what's being yelled at Jesus while he's hoisted up on the cross. Matthew 27, verses 41 and 42. In the same way, the chief priests also, along with the scribes and elders, were mocking him and saying, he saved others, he cannot save himself. He is the king of Israel. Let him come down now from the cross. Then we will believe in him. Now this raises a question. Are these men right? Could Jesus have come down from the cross? The answer is yes and no. Yes and no. Hear me out. You don't have to turn to this one. I'm just going to read it to you. Think about this. Jesus says this in John chapter 10. He says, for this reason the Father loves me, because I lay down my life so that I may take it up again. No one has taken it away from me, but I lay it down on my own initiative. I have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it up again. This commandment I received from my Father. Jesus had the power and authority to lay down his life and take it up again. There is no doubt that he could have aborted the mission he came to do. But again, he endured the cross because of the joy set before him. Now, during the crucifixion, come back to these scoffers. Here they are, yelling at him and telling him that he can save others, but he can't save himself. In another sense, they're right. In another sense, they're right. And this is profound. I want you to think about it. As far, you're like, what are you talking about? This doesn't make sense. They're mocking him saying this. And as far as ability goes, absolutely, he could have gotten off the cross. But that's not what we're talking about. This should bring it together. In order to save others, he could not save himself, because we can't save ourselves. In order for God to save sinners, Christ could not get down from the cross. He could not save himself because it was the only way he could save you and me and all who will call on his name. You see, God is righteous. God is righteous. He cannot sin. Righteousness and justice surround his throne, the psalmist says. He is holy, holy, holy. But here's the issue. You're not. We are sinful. We all fall short of the glory of God. We cannot please him with our own righteousness. We cannot trust in ourselves to be justified before our holy God. We are not worthy. Now you might ask, why doesn't he just overlook my sin? He's so gracious. Why doesn't he just, yeah, I'm okay. And the average mindset of the person is, I'm a decent person. God will understand me. No, he will not. No, he will not. He cannot overlook sin. Let me give you an illustration and tell you why. Let's say someone stole a bunch of your stuff and set your house on fire. And they caught him. And he goes to court. And he sits down and the judge comes in. The judge says, you know what, guys? I'm feeling really gracious today. You know what? You just go on out the door. You're fine. I forgive you. Problem is, it's your stuff. Your house. He set my house on fire. He's going to let him go free? Up the stakes. Let's say somebody fatally wounds someone that you love. And the judge gets up and says, I'm feeling extremely gracious today and forgiving. Why don't you just go ahead and go? No charges. How would you feel if that were you? I would be indignant. I would be enraged. That is unjust. How can you let him go free? It's very much the same with God and your sin. In order to be a just judge, the debt has to be settled. Has to be settled. And the wages of sin is what? Death. We are not worthy of God because of our sin. So what hope do you or I have before a holy God? Your sin, my sin, it has to be dealt with. It has to be dealt with. Payment has to be made. God would not be just anymore if he didn't take care of it. So who is worthy? Who is worthy to stand before God? Who will deliver me from this body of death? Who will save me? And here comes Jesus again. If you trust in Jesus, here's what happens. He stands up and he takes the payment. He takes the payment owed to God from you. He takes away your wrath owed to you and gives you the cup of blessing. We just celebrated that in communion. He clothes you with his own righteousness, never sinned in his living and his suffering, never trace of any sin. His life imputed to you. He clothes you in his righteousness. He is the sacrificial lamb for sinners who trust in him by faith. He is what the Passover festival in the Old Testament was pointing forward to. If you haven't ever studied it, take time and do it. Here is the true and greater Passover lamb lifted up on a cross to pay for the sins he didn't commit so sinners could go free. The innocent has to be sacrificed for the guilty. It took God to do it. Totally God, totally man. He saved others, but he couldn't save himself. Christ crucified for you and for me. And that's what Good Friday is all about, and that's why we call it good. Consider the words from this modern hymn. Behold the man upon the cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed, I hear my mocking voice calling out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. It is finished, he cried. He bowed his head and gave up his spirit. So what's all this have to do with anything? If he died, but he did not come back to life, we are most to be pitied. But Jesus didn't stay dead. Back in 1 Corinthians 15, I want to read you three more verses from there. Remember, if Christ didn't rise from the dead, we're the most to be pitied. But looking at verses 20 through 22 in 1 Corinthians 15, but now Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who are asleep. For since by a man came death, by a man also came the resurrection of the dead. Now Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who are asleep. For as in Adam all die, so in Christ all will be made alive. Oh yeah. Here comes point number three. Because of the resurrection, we can be right with God by faith in the work of Jesus Christ. There it is. Here comes the good news. I've told you a lot of bad news today. Now the good news is going to actually be good. Christ has risen from the grave. All those who place their trust in Jesus Christ are raised to newness of life with Him. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. He is worthy. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. He conquered death and sin by raising from the grave. And that's why we celebrate Easter Sunday. Praise God. Amen. Amen. We celebrate God's power over sin and death, reconciling unworthy sinners by His own blood, disarming the sting of death, making us worthy, or right with God, because Christ is worthy. Because He is worthy. Death no longer is the stronger. Hell itself is captive, led. Satan's fighting a losing battle. We've already won. Because Christ is worthy. Christ won it for us. Do you trust in the only one who is truly worthy? Can you see why the gospel literally means good news? I'm borrowing this from another pastor. It's so good, I had to use it. Thank you, brother. We are unworthy of Christ. Before I say this, let me say something. We live in a culture obsessed with my worth and identity. Obsessed with it. I don't know if it's just a byproduct of our American worldview or philosophy. But people are miserable because they're told to look inside the mirror, look in yourself. I am man, I am woman, hear me roar. I am powerful, I am empowered, and it's a lie. It makes you miserable. You know what you need to do, brother, sister? You need to focus on yourself some more. What? But I'm a wreck. It's a lie. It's a lie. Look away from yourself. Look away from yourself. Look to Christ. You want to have newness of life? You want to actually find joy and peace and happiness? Look away from yourself. Look to Christ. He says this, we are unworthy of Christ, and we have great worth because of Christ. Christ died for us not because we are worthy, but because we are unworthy, and there was no other way for us to be made worthy. Coming back to this same mindset, it wasn't a fair trade. The Son of God died, rebels lived. That's not fair. That's what we call grace. Do you feel the world is broken? Is all creation groaning? Yes. It's eagerly awaiting to be renewed like a woman in childbirth. But there is a sense in which the substance of that renewal has already come. Is sin abounding today? Yes, but grace is abounding much more. And this is why I asked if any of you have ever cried out over your sin. I'm telling you there's an answer. Christ is making all things new. Have you confessed that Jesus is Lord? Have you made Him your Lord? No one is worthy to stand before God. No one is worthy to stand in a pulpit, let alone sit in a chair and talk about God. We're not even worthy of that. We're worthy of death. But by the blood of the true and the better Adam, the spotless Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, Jesus Christ makes sinners right. Is anyone worthy? Is anyone able to redeem this earth and bring many sons and daughters to glory? Yes, he is able. They say this about him. The elders in heaven sang a new song in heaven. They say this: worthy are you to take the book and to break its seals, for you were slain and purchased for God with your blood, men from every tribe and tongue and people and nation. Folks, this is the gospel. For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Don't stop there. Everybody stops there when they read that. Most people know John 3:16. John 3:17 is the answer for what's going on out there. For God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but the world might be saved through him. The world is condemned already. But Christ is the way. Christ offers the way. But because Jesus rose from the dead, he saves sinners who call upon his name. That's the significance of the resurrection. Jesus has purchased people by his own blood. Priest and sacrifice, same time. This is what he means when he cries out, "It is finished! The work is done!" And don't think that me or anybody else is simply asking you to try Jesus as if he were some other form of self-help. That is not it. There is no power in that. I'm not asking you to try Jesus. God doesn't ask you to try Jesus. He commands men and women everywhere to repent. He commands them to repent. He doesn't just come, "Hey, you want to try Jesus?" No. We serve a holy God, an awesome God. And he is much more powerful to save, more than you or I are powerful to resist him. He is so powerful. He is not a way, but the way. We have an obligation to call people to repentance. Whoever calls on him is crucified with him and raised to newness of life. So let's bring the thought full circle. Do you know him? Are your garments spotless? Are you able to say, "Thank you, Jesus, for the blood applied," and mean it? There are several brothers and sisters who have gone before us, who have confessed Jesus as Lord. And let me be extremely clear. If you want to see them again, you have to want to see Jesus more. If you want to see a lost loved one who has already gone to be with the Lord, you got to want Jesus more than anything else. Jesus has to be the most desired treasure of your heart. And I can promise you this. He's the only one worthy of that place in your life. He's the only one worthy. Not music, not sports, not anything. Anything that you take and make greater than God in your heart becomes an idol. And it's not worthy of the place that you've put it. The only one worthy of that place is God. Do you trust in him? Many others have come and gone, claiming divine authority or some other way or some mystical life force that holds us all together. All of them are dead. Muhammad is dead. Buddha's dead. Pharaoh is dead. Pharaoh claimed to be God. He's dead. Jesus is alive. He is risen. Some people have been raised. Think about this. Some people were raised back to life by Jesus, and then they died again. But Jesus is the only person who ever died, came back to life, and stayed alive. Amen. In John 11, and I'm coming near the end, guys, Jesus was on his way to raise Lazarus from the dead. He's talking to Martha about Lazarus, and Jesus says this, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even if he dies. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? Her answer was, yes, Lord. So I ask you, do you believe this? Though we all die in Adam, we can all be made alive in Christ. Jesus is the ruler of the kings of the earth, and he will return someday to judge the living and the dead. Christ has died, Christ is risen, he's going to come back again. I pray that you know him. I pray that you know him. Some will go into outer darkness, but others who place their trust in him will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And it depends on this thing that I've been harping on since I got up here in front of you. Do you know him? Do you trust in what he's done? Or are you trusting in yourself? There's no hope for that. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. He alone is worthy of your praise. If you trust him, I know some of you are like, I already got the gospel. I've heard the gospel before. Well, I've moved on to that. I want something deeper. Friend, go back. You're missing the boat. You're missing the forest for the trees. The gospel is good for the sinner and for the believer and the unbeliever, because we're so prone to get back on the treadmill and try to please God by our own works. The gospel says somebody's already finished the work for you. If you don't know the Lord, call upon him while it's still today. And I got to tell you this, folks. Till sin be bitter, Christ will not be sweet. Till you don't like your sin, Christ will not be worthy to you. Christ will not be sweet. I pray the Holy Spirit comes and illuminates the idols of our hearts. May he convict us of our sins so we realize how much more infinitely worthy he is. And I'm going to tell you this, people. Examine yourself. Examine yourself. Examine your affections, the inner person. Examine yourself. I'm available to talk to anybody afterward about anything if you want to. But listen, I can give my child broccoli, but I can't make him want it. I can't make him desire it. I can put a sport coat on a pig, but it doesn't make him a fashion statement. He's still a pig. I put a piece of lettuce in front of a vulture and a rabbit, the rabbit's going to take it. If I put a piece of meat in front of him, if the vulture didn't grab the rabbit, he's going to go for the meat. It's in its nature. We're talking about nature. If you're in Christ, you're a new creation. Your affections have changed. Same thing that happens if you put somebody dead in sin in front of God and their sinner and their own sin. They're going to take their sin every time. They're going to take their sin every time. But if you redeem the man, if you take what is natural and change the nature to a new creation, you will find him choosing God over his sin. I want you to think about that. That's called religious affections. Affections of the heart. Other people would call it the work of the Holy Spirit. I pray that we all know him. That we all know him. Let's pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the truth that is found in Jesus. The fact that we all have the promise and the hope because Jesus rose from the dead. Because God, you defeated death. And now we can say with you, O death, where is your sting? God, I pray that you reveal this deep down into the souls and hearts of all of us this morning. that we may truly know you and who you are. Not just about you, but to be come to a point like the Apostle Paul said when he desired to know nothing among people except Jesus Christ and him crucified. That the worth of knowing Jesus Christ made him forsake everything else, because he had found a treasure that was worthy of his praise, that was unworldly. God, I pray that you take the gospel and continue to spread it and to work on our hearts. You promise us, God, that the gospel is your power and that the Holy Spirit does the work and we're just the conductor. Lord, thank you for Easter Sunday. Pray for everyone that came this morning, all the families, all the kids. I thank you that we get to celebrate freely. We get to come together and think about and eat good food and talk about fun things. Lord, we thank you for all those many graces of life that you've supplied for us. Lord, help us as we do those things, anything that we go out from here and do today, we just ask that we do it by your grace and for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.